What's up guys, welcome to another video on the channel and excuse me for the shaky footage at some parts. What we have here is a motherboard that I'm going to troubleshoot and try fixing it. I got it for a good deal for the purpose of making this video and also a future build with it considering the problems it had. The motherboard is Asus Maximus III Gene bundled with i7-860. On the test bench we have also R9270X from XFX, 16 gigs of memory, and the power supply is Corsair RM650X, I think. Yeah, it's 650X. Oh yeah, and the SSD is Samsung Evo 840 with 250 gigs. So I've got the motherboard and the CPU for $60, which I later sold for $35. And that makes the real cost of the motherboard about $25. First problem was that the sound was not working, I guess the onboard audio is gone. The second problem happens when you unplug the power supply from the power or when you turn it off from the switch so that there is no power connected to the board. Then when you connect it to the power, the only way you can turn it on is to clear the CMOS first, otherwise it won't post at all. So I think this is a BIOS failure and I will try some basic methods to fix it. The sound issue is a minor for me, neither the back ports are working, neither the front HD audio header, but you can still have audio from the graphics card or even an external PCI card that I also got with the bundle for free. Now I'm going to do a little demonstration. First, let's shut down the computer. Then turn off the power supply from the switch and turn it on again. Now when you press start, the board doesn't post at all. So let's clear the CMOS from the back button by holding it for a few seconds. After you release it, it lights up in green color, which means you are ready. Now when you press start, we have a successful post and boot. And everything in BIOS looks normal. So what we are going to try is to downgrade the BIOS version since it's with the latest already. Not sure if it's going to work with Easy Flash, so I made my flash drive bootable with FreeDOS and got AlphaDOS in it for just in case. Now let's try first with Easy Flash. As you can see, the BIOS version is 2202 and it's the latest for this motherboard. Select your flash drive device from the list on the left and then select the ROM file. In that case, it's 2103. Yes, we are sure we want to update. And it worked! When we checked the BIOS version, it was showing 2103, so everything is good. For now at least. Unfortunately, that didn't pay well and the problem still existed. I've tried different versions, went as far back as I could, downgraded, upgraded back to the latest ROM, but without any luck. Which brings us to our next try, cleaning the motherboard. Here is a quick overview how dirty and rusted the motherboard is. At least the socket is in good condition with no bended pins. These are the I/O audio ports and the front headers. I have a very little doubt cleaning will help it, but still I have to try. Overall, it's a premium board from Asus for the time period it was released, and even now with those cheap overclockable Xeons, it can handle a lot of games if paired with a decent enough graphics card. So the tools we need are brushes, paint or tooth will do the job, and a lot of isopropyl alcohol. Let's start with removing the heatsink from the chipset and the VRMs. You can do so by removing the screws on the other side of the motherboard. The thermal paste on the chipset looks very dry, and the thermal pads on the MOSFET as well looks dried out. This is the heatsink for the VRMs, and you can tell that the thermal pads haven't been changed at all. I removed it and then cleaned the residues on the heatsink with alcohol and cotton buds. This is what it should look like. Did the same with the heatsink for the chipset, and this is the final result. Then I soaked the chipset with a lot of alcohol and did a lot of scrubbing and polishing to reach this result. Now it's time to clean the PCB itself with alcohol. I used a toothbrush that has a soft bristle. Isopropyl alcohol is safe to use for cleaning electrical parts, so don't worry. Just make sure to remove the CMOS battery before doing so. Now after the board is clean, I apply thermal paste over the chipset and spread it over with a business card. I used Arctic MX2 and the final result should look like this. And after that, install the heatsink. The MOSFETs are looking good to go, the heatsink as well. This is the thermal pads that I applied over. Make sure you always have some on hand. Then I installed the heatsink, aligned it properly and added the screws. Don't do it so tight because you can crack the MOSFETs. And then unfortunately that didn't help as well. So my final attempt was to replace the BIOS chip. And if you have long nose pliers, it's easier to replace it. I didn't, so I used a flat screwdriver, which also works. So this is the old chip, it was kinda rusty as you can see. And this is the new one that I ordered from eBay for $10. Orient the notched end of the chip so that it aligns with the notch on the socket. Also, make sure that all the chip's legs are straight and perfectly in line. Otherwise, you risk to bend or crack them. And that's all. Easy peasy. Then I built a test bench, eager to see if it helped. And yes, the clear CMOS button on the back lighted up as soon as I switched on the power supply, which was a good indicator. And when I pressed start, it worked. So I loaded the default settings just to make sure it will boot to Windows successfully. And it did. Unfortunately, I didn't have the same success with the audio, but still I was happy with the outcome. I hope this video was helpful for you. Some of the methods might work, some of them might not work for you, but these are just the basic steps that you can try if you have similar problems. Obviously, the parts for my next build are ready. Stay tuned and subscribe to the channel if you want to see that as well. Stay safe guys, and till next time. So this is what happened after I cleaned the motherboard and did a quick test. The CPU fan was spinning without any power connected to the board. Obviously, it was from the HDMI because this was the only thing connected to the board. Unplugging and plugging it back confirmed that. And I was shocked how it was even possible. Then I realized that the other end of the cable was not connected to my monitor, but to my running PC. Oops,